Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, when I was asked a couple of months ago to give a laudatio to Luboš Dobrovský, our today's Czech and Slovak Transatlantic Award winner, I enthusiastically agreed. He's a friend of mine for more than 30 years. I had the privilege to work with him on many occasions, and I do have a high regard about his personal contribution to the liberation of our country from communist and Soviet domination. But then, when GLOBSEC was coming closer and closer, I recognized how challenging it is to introduce him to you. He's not a conference type of animal who is just used to travel from one talk show to another. He does not speak English, and he does not publish his views on the pages of the world newspapers. In the politics, he was the first Czechoslovak civilian minister of defense right after the Velvet Revolution, and then was a chancellor to President Václav Havel, but it had occurred a long time ago. Therefore, I have a feeling that the most of people in this room simply does not know him enough. And yet, it was Luboš Dobrovský who led the tough talks and negotiations with the Soviets on the withdrawal of Russian troops from Czechoslovakia in the early 1990s, while many at home and abroad believe that the credit goes to the rock star musician named Michal Kocáb, who mostly monitoring what Luboš has agreed earlier. And also, it was Defense Minister Luboš Dobrovský who led the Czechoslovak armed forces, this famous battalion of NPC protection soldiers, to their first ever foreign mission during the Gulf War with our future US and the British allies, and thus he paved the road to our future entry into NATO. And finally, it was Luboš Dobrovský who had publicly recognized then the new elected Russian President Vladimir Putin as a challenge and a problem to the Western world when he was serving as Havel's ambassador in Moscow, and when the Western mainstream politicians and media as well still believe that Putin is somebody with whom we can make a business as usual, or that we can even trust him just looking into his eyes. If I will be pressed to characterize Luboš by a single word, I would probably say something like a compass or a character. A compass for the time of uncertainty, or a character which does not sell morality for a joke. As a son of a Jewish father who was killed by the Nazis in concentration camp, as a young boy who was growing up in Stalinist Czechoslovakia, and as a student deeply educated in Polish and Russian history, had never had any illusions about the communist or Soviet regimes. Contrary to many of his close friends, like Jiří Dinsbier, with whom he worked together as a reporter for Czechoslovak Radio and journalist, he did not compromise. And it had even had to take into account pragmatic attitudes in the past. He had departed from them immediately when, as the Czech radio reporter oversaw in Kremlin in 1968, during the famous August occupation, how Alexander Dubček, a leader of the famous Prague Spring, was kidnapped to Moscow and forced to pay a tribute to Leonid Brezhnev. The road for Luboš to the Czech descent was wide open. It is not surprising that Luboš Dobrovský delivered one of the first signatures on the Charter 77. During the day, he was cleaning the windows in the Prague shops together with Miroslav, who later became the Czech cardinal, and Jaroslav Šedivý, who later was appointed as the Czech foreign minister, and his signature is under the treaty on the accession of the Czech Republic into NATO. And in the evening, he was publishing the Samizdat magazines. Later he has said, from the current perspective, it was an easy life for us. We were and they were. There was nothing in between us. The enemy was clearly defined. When communism was coming to its end in my country, Luboš Dobrovský was among the first to serve the newly restored Free and Democratic Republic. He was the spokesman for the Civic Forum. He was a deputy to Foreign Minister Jedinspiel, and then President Havel asked him to reform the Czechoslovak defense as the first civilian minister of defense. Later, he served as his chancellor in the castle, and as a perfectionist, he had a vision that the office of the president should operate like a Swiss watches, something that the current Czech president is terribly missing. Luboš had closed his professional career as Václav Havel's ambassador to Russia. Not surprisingly, because the knowledge on the Russian culture and politics is his prime expertise. It is here when his realistic and non-illusionary voice and attitude is always noticeable, even after his retirement. He was the first to express doubts about the policy of the so-called reset. His response to Vladimir Putin and Joe Biden's words in Munich Security Conference a couple of years ago was clear. I quote, "We cannot cut off anything that we have gone through. It is important to remember what has happened to us in the past." Yes, the worst thing that may happen to us is to forget. Then the history can repeat again. We can forgive, but we should not forget. Let me quote Luboš Dobrovský for the last and final time. "It is not Russia itself what threatened us most. It is rather our weakness and its inability of many European leaders to see Russia as a problem, as a threat, as a challenge." Golden words, I would want to add. We should listen to them more than any time before. Dear Luboš, welcome in Bratislava, and please take the floor. And I would also like to ask Stuart Butler to join us here from BA System, which will present the award to dear Luboš Dobrovský. Luboš, thank you.
Très bien. Dans notre jeunesse, nous avons préféré la langue française sans réserve comme la langue diplomatique. Et c'est pourquoi je ne parle pas anglais, mais je dois dire aussi que je suis un homme bien paroché pour apprendre les autres langues. Je suis désolé, mais par cette raison, je dois venir continuer avec votre contestement en tchèque avec appui votre interprète. Dámy a pánové, mé rozpaky, který se mi dostává, mají více příčin. Ta první spočívá v tom, že o oprávněnost té pocty, které se mi dostalo, že se jí dostalo právě mně, nemám žádnou jistotu. Můj starý přítel Saša Vondra se sice pokusil připomenout nějaké drobnosti z mého života, kterými snad jsem alespoň jeho názoru přispěl k zlepšení naší bezpečnostní situace. Ale ty rozpaky nemají jenom tu zcela osobní, individuální příčinu. Ta druhá příčina není osobní. Je zřejmé, když se dívám kolem sebe, že my všichni společně, tedy ani já, neučinili jsme dost pro naši vnější bezpečnost.
Ladies and gentlemen, me being perplexed by receiving this honor has a twofold reason. The first is that I am not fully sure whether I am truly eligible to receive this honor, although my good friend Sasha Vondra reminded me and reminded you about some things I did for our joint security.
Nedošli jsme včas dost důvodů a dost politické odvahy k pojmenování nositele rozhodující militární hrozby, který zcela otevřeně svými politickými cíly a agresivitou, nejen verbální, ale i faktickou, jednáním svých ozbrojených sil, ohrožuje bezpečnost demokratické Evropy. Vojenskou silou prosazené odtržení části Gruzie, které zůstalo bez důsledné politické odpovědi, posílilo dávný agresorův cíl připravit a realizovat násilnou anexi Krymu a přímo vojenskou účast na ozbrojené vzpouře ruskojazyčné části levobřežní Ukrajiny. Nejde pouze o rozvrat napadeného suverénního státu. Jde o nelad, který má být vnesen do celé demokratické
The second reason, however, is not personal. It is obvious when I look around that neither we together or me personally have done enough for our external security. We haven't found reasons enough and we haven't found political courage to point the finger to the bearer of the decisive military threat who quite openly through its political objectives and aggression, not only verbal aggression but also factual aggression of its armed forces is threatening the security of the democratic Europe. Ripping part of the sovereign country of Georgia by military might has remained without consequential political answer and has only reinforced very ancient and well-prepared objective of the aggressor, and that is to prepare and execute violent annexation of Crimea, and to directly support by military personnel the armed rebellion of Russian-speaking part of the Ukraine of the left bank. It is not only about a collapse of sovereign state under attack. It is a discord that is being systematically sown into our democratic Europe.
Od okamžiku rozpadu Sovětského svazu přežívala v našich myslích a v našich bezpečnostních dokumentech iluze, že nejméně 20 let žádná vnější vojenská hrozba nepřipadá v úvahu. Kdo tu iluzi odmítal, byl obvykle jako já ve výroku jednoho ruského velvyslance v České republice nazván reliktem studené války. Iluze o neexistenci vážné vnější militární hrozby měla své neblahé důsledky. Své profesionalizované ozbrojené síly jsme budovali bez záloh a tudíž bez reálných mobilizačních schopností. Propadali jsme, a dosud někteří z nás propadají další chybné iluzi, že armády lze použít k zajištění vnitřní bezpečnosti, například proti migrantům, či k rozmnožení policie.
From the moment the Soviet Union collapsed, there was an illusion living in our minds and, most of all, in our security documentation that for at least 20 years there is no direct military threat. Whoever refused this illusion was usually called a relic of the Cold War by Russian ambassador, as it happened to me. Illusion about non-existing serious military threat had its very unfavorable consequences. We have built our professional and professionalized military forces without reserves and therefore without true and real mobilization capabilities. We were living, and some of us still are living, in the illusion that armies serve mainly the purpose for securing the internal safety and security, and that they should be used, for example, against migrants, or that they should serve the purpose of expanding the ranks of police.
Spokojili jsme se schopností vytvářet nevelká funkční úkolová uskupení a do společné alianční obrany v případě aktivace 5. článku smlouvy vyčleňujeme v našem českém případě jednu střední brigádu s nedostatečnou plevnou podporou bez schopnosti doplňování strát. To není jen chybné, to je ostudné.
We have satisfied ourselves by creating minor functional task forces, and we are investing into our joint alliance defense in case the Article 5 is invoked, only one medium-sized brigade with insufficient fire support, without the ability to compensate for the losses. This is not only erroneous, this is shameful.
Demokratická Evropa, jejíž součástí jsme se po rozpadu Sovětského svazu stali, nemá z příčin převážně primitivně nacionalistických společně garantovanou bezpečnost. Těšíme se v našem evropském nedostatečném obranném úsilí podpoře Spojených států. Spoléháme na ní však do takové míry, že naše evropská bezpečnost hraničí s plnou závislostí na jejich vojenské síle. Prezident Trump nám to poněkud nešetrně připomněl. Měli bychom se méně zabývat hodností či nevhodností formy Trumpova výroku a měli bychom více pozornosti věnovat posílení stavu souboru našich evropských obranných schopností. Samozřejmě, že zásadně v rámci aliance.
The democratic Europe, whose part we form, has, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, does not possess any guaranteed security, mainly for the reasons that are primitively nationalistic. Although we are basking in the lights of security provided by the United States, we as Europeans lack the efforts ourselves. We are relying on the Americans providing our security to that extent that we are fully depending on it. President Trump was quite insensitive when he reminded us about this fact. However, we should not ponder whether the utterance of Mr. Trump was or was not sensitive, and we should focus more on reinforcing the set of our own European defense capabilities. Of course, only and exclusively within the framework of the alliance.
Podmínkou efektivní evropské bezpečnosti je nalezení politické vůle, k vytvoření a k realizování zásad společné zahraniční politiky, z níž jedině může společná politika obranná vycházet. Současní představitelé států střední a východní Evropy, jimž se podařilo po pádu Sovětského svazu znovu se vrátit mezi svobodné demokratické státy, okouzlení svobodou, kterou přináší demokracie, upadají do nebezpečných osídel nacionalismu, propadají iluzím o jakési nezbytné suverenitě národních států a neodpovědně odmítají společná evropská řešení zásadních otázek uchování oné těžce nabité svobody.
The precondition of efficient European security is finding the political will to create and implement the principles of the common foreign policy on which the common defense policy must be built. The current representatives of the states of Central and Eastern Europe, who have successfully returned to the family of the democratic states after the collapse of the Soviet Union, were perhaps too much enchanted by the freedom and liberties brought around by democracy, so much that I am falling back to the jaws of nationalism and are living under the illusion that a certain sovereignty of the national states is so necessary that they irresponsibly refuse common and joint European solutions of principal questions in order to maintain the liberty and freedom.
Nezbývá, myslím, než hledat řešení naší společné obrany nejen podle článku 5. Washingtonské smlouvy, ale nejprve podle článku 3. Ten nám klade za povinnost připravit se na obranu v maximální míře, jaké je každý člen aliance schopen. Podmínkou porozumění tomuto úkolu je vědomí, že aliance existuje pouze jako soubor odpovědností všech jejich jednotlivých členů. K takovému názorovému souladu se pokusme přispět hledáním společné bezpečnosti aliance jako celku, vyznávajícího demokracii jako podmínku bezpečnosti.
I think that we have to look for the solution for our common defense policy, and not only invoking Article 5 of the Washington Treaty when necessary, but we also should take a better look to the Article 3. That gives us the obligation and the duty to prepare in the maximum possible extent for our common defense, which is appropriate to the capabilities of the individual states. If we should understand this correctly, we have to see that the alliance is only as strong as it's the summary of the responsibilities of its individual members. We have to therefore seek the joint and common defense in the alliance as a group of members that cherish democracy as the precondition for our security.
Velmi vlastně dojat. Děkuju výboru, který mě tou cenou, kterou jsem právě obdržel, poctil. Děkuju Sašovi Vondrovi, že si o mě myslí to, co tady řekl. Obojí mě potěšilo. Und damit sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, ich danke Ihnen für Ihre Geduld.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the end, I would like to thank the committee who bestowed this award on me, and also I would like to thank my friend Sasha Vondra for really thinking what he said about